Hi everybody, Danny here from ERG, and as you might know, I'm a big PlayStation fanatic, so I did pre-order a PlayStation Classic Mini, did receive it, and as with many people, I was a little bit disappointed with the emulation, not so much the game selection, I'm fine with that, but I was hoping for it to be hackable pretty soon, and it came sooner as expected, so I already applied the now known way to soft hack your PlayStation Classic Mini, which involves a USB stick, some software, and ISOs. And as you can see, I have added Bloody Roar 2 to the interface. And what we're going to do now is check out how the game actually runs on the emulation. I'm not sure which version this is, if it's a PAL or NTSC version of the game, because it is in my stack of ISOs I have on my computer and run via emulation as well. So I know it runs well on emulation, but let's see how it runs on the PlayStation Classic Mini.
Bloody Roar 2, the new breed. Bakuru, the mole.
Sheena,
the leopard.
As you can see here, the game runs pretty smooth. It's no real lag, apart from lag that's created by the game itself, but the emulation is not causing any problem.
Bakuru, the mole, the tiger.
Also, I didn't notice any controller lag of any noticeable kind, so I think this is just working really good on emulation. The cool thing is you can add one game or you can add more games, but you do have to do some iffy stuff that if you mess that up, you can break your PlayStation Classic Mini, so you have to have a bit of knowledge of SQL or SQL and database structures or multi-table databases to know what you're really doing and not destroy the database of the game, because if you do so, what's happening is you have a USB stick and there's a payload up in there, and it's overriding the original database of the system. And the database contains all the link files, the file links to different games. If you override that, and for instance, you remove games, original games that were on there in the database, then you're destroying the link to that game and the game won't be available anymore. What you see here, this is the actual software you have to download. It's on GitHub. I'll put the link in the description. It's a zip file with a little bit of software that is LolHack. LolHack is a payloader which you use to access the system. And when you download that, it contains a LolHack folder. It contains a game folder and a folder with a hash as a file name. You kind of leave that untouched. You go into the game folder, and in that folder, you will find another folder that's called 21. 21 identifies the game on the system. So there are 20 games installed. This is the 21st game. In that folder, you will find a couple of files, the actual ROM files, as you can see here, and they're identified with SCUS and a number. There's a bin file and a Q file, just like a normal ISO. And what you do is you copy your game files, your ISO of your game you want to play, to this directory, and you rename them to the names that are used here. Then you can also, it will say, if you boot it up, then it will say something like custom game. If you want to change all that information into actual game information, you can edit that in a database, but you have to have a database editor. I will add a link to the database editor as well. But again, this is pretty dangerous to edit. If you mess this up, you're going to break your system. So what you're going to see here is the contents of the database of the game table. This is the table that contains all the games that are on the system. As you can see, the 21st row is a row of the added game and the information in regards to that game. So I changed that to Bloody Roar 2, Hudson Soft, and 1999, which is the game release year. And if you change that and you upload that to a USB stick, you just put the USB stick in your system, but you make sure that you take the power off first. You put in the USB stick in the second player port, and you put the power back on. The biggest problem with this hack is that you cannot use the player 2 controller anymore in this fashion. So the real solution for the future will be that you can actually override the internal software. The only thing you override now on the internal software is the database with the game information. So when you boot the system, the game is there and you can play it. And the cool thing is, as you saw a little bit back, is that it keeps a save state of this game as well, which you can use. But if you change the game, it will override the same save state. But that seems quite logical to me. And if you wish to play the original games with a two-player option, then you can unplug it when the power is off and just start the system, and then you will have an empty spot in your system, in your interface, because it cannot find the ROM or the PNG file. I forgot to mention that you also have to change the PNG file, which is the thumbnail showing the game. So you can just boot any other game if you don't have the USB installed. But it has already overwritten the databases. That's why it's still visible in the user interface. And if you want to roll back to the original database, then you can use the basic file of the file package you downloaded, which contains the original database as well. Today, a couple of additional features are added to this hack method. It's now possible to add up to 25 games in total, including the original games. So you can add another 5 games. But they also found a way to up the maximum of games in the system. So you can now double that to 50 games. But you need to be able to change the database for that, as well as add some additional scripts. Also, there's a method introduced which you have to add to the script file, which makes it possible to make an image swapper for the game installed. So that's a possibility as well, and then you don't have to change the database information. So it is a little less intrusive method of changing games on the system. And you can have infinite games without any limitation, only to the size of your USB stick. So hopefully this information is a little bit helpful. I also would like to send you to Matt Little Pixels, a YouTube channel who came up first, at least on the internet, on YouTube, with this information, which I started rolling from. And there's a lot of information on Reddit in regards to this hack. Okay, thank you. If you find this information useful, please like and subscribe and click the notification bell. And thanks for watching. Bye.